in search of soil.
I really love the idea of these perennial ground covers because it just decreases work. No tilling, less weeding, you're always feeding the soil, less composting, you're really only composting as needed with crop waste, crop residue. But by removing some of this composting from the system and by having perennial ground cover always in the system, and by selling a cash crop, how do you deal with nutrient replacement? If you're selling a cash crop, by default, you're exporting nutrients from your property because when the vegetables leave, they take nutrients that came out of the soil with them. How do you get those nutrients back in the soil in a perennial ground cover type situation where you're not adding a lot of compost to the surface? Another way of asking that is, what are your thoughts on soil remineralization? And is it necessary?
Because your soil is replenishing itself with all those nutrients by the fact that the bacteria and fungi use their acids, they use their enzymes to break down pebbles and rocks and larger chunks and boulders, and the bedrock is all being broken down. And that means more sand, silt, clay particles are being replenished. So, you know, you might be chewing up some of the sand, silt, and clay and pulling all the nutrients out of them. But down here in the lower part of the soil, you know, whatever depth your soil is, every second of every day, more sand, silt, and clay are being made. And so till the day that you've chewed up all that sand, silt, and clay, all of the organic matter, because remember, the organic matter has all those nutrients in it too, already in the right balances. So what's wrong with growing plants in pure organic matter? It's got all the nutrients. You just have the biology. You have to have that biology in order to pull those nutrients out of that matrix that they're in, pull it inside their bodies, and then they've got to get eaten by the protozoa, the nematodes, the microarthropods, the earthworms, all of those good kids. And that's what releases those nutrients in plant available forms right next to the root. The root doesn't have to do any work. It just can take up very simple right from the local surrounding area. It doesn't have to try to transport that nitrogen from 2 feet away. How long is it going to take that nitrogen to get to the root system if it's 2 feet away? Well, you've got a dead plant before it ever gets there. So all of those nutrients are in the sand, the silt, the clays, the rocks, the pebbles. And so when you think about that silica bilayer that all of these mineral components of the soil are built, and in between that silica bilayer are all of the nutrients have already been pulled inside those structures, all you've got to have are the bacteria and fungi with their enzymes come along and pull out the specific nutrients that the plant's asking for. Look, I want boron. I'll give you this food if you go out and bring me back the boron. And then, you know, over here it's saying, I need more zinc. I need more iron. The plant is telling that biology exactly what the plant needs and exactly what the bacteria and fungi should be bringing them back for the plant.
What about replenishing nitrogen in the system? That's a big nutrient I think a lot of people freak out about. Where's the nitrogen coming from?
It's especially for nitrogen, we have a couple of alternative forms of obtaining nitrogen straight from the atmosphere in terms of nitrogen fixation. So if you have any of the legumes, if you've got any free-living nitrogen fixers, those organisms can fix nitrogen. And that's one of the things about soil scientists and the way they explain the nitrogen cycle. They forget to tell you about any of the biology, any of the organisms that have to be there. It is the organisms that do all the transformations of the nitrogen from N2 gas into amino acids. That's the next step in the nitrogen cycle. You always read these papers that say nitrate was produced and released into the soil by these nitrogen fixing microorganisms. No, That is not true. That is not how it works. They forget a whole bunch of the biological steps that have to occur to convert from N2 into NH4 or NO3. So I go through that whole nitrogen cycle and how it actually works and show people what organisms are required for each step along the way. And, you know, it is one more form, one more way to get that nitrogen into the soil in the proper form. What's the balance? NH4, NO3. It is the microorganisms that determine what kind of plant you're going to be growing. And so most of the time, you don't have to have nitrogen-fixing microorganisms to do that job. Legumes and free-living nitrogen fixers, you know, the rhizobium and free-living nitrogen fixers, are a small part of that pool. If you've got normal bacterium fungi doing what the plant tells them, there is a massive amount of nitrogen present in the mineral forms of the soil, in the sandsill, clay, rocks, and pebbles, etc. Your plant can live on that nitrogen. You don't have to add the nitrogen fixation. Well, you know, but why not make one of your understory plants a legume of some kind? Yeah. Grow some, any one of those nitrogen-fixing plants. Grow them in that mix, and you're just adding nitrogen icing on top of the cake.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for watching. Subscribe here to get the latest from the show. Also, be sure to check out some of the great clips and watch the full interviews right here on In Search of Soil.